consistent with their own character and love for freedom. And the people refuse to accept these colonial governments' restrictive administrative measures.
In the late 1950s, I was an applicant for scholarship to study engineering. I was actually working with the ECN as assistant technical officer in Ibadan. By 1955-56, scholarships that were given out by the Western region to people from Edo and Delta areas of the Western region at that time were for shoemaking, for rubber processing, that kind of thing. But it was okay that to the extent that we had rubber and we could process, them, you know, if we knew how, you know. But the interesting thing was that scholarships for engineering, for medicine, and for things like that were reserved, you know, for the Western region, you know. But of course, when we ruled ourselves, we gave to all of our people that we are beautiful. Some of us had to wait. I didn't get scholarship until 1958. You know, I have federal scholarship to study engineering. In the UK,
about Kaiser II, about Benin, adroitly watered the seed of political emancipation with the active support of eminent visionaries and statesmen like Chief Humphrey Omosadi, Oba Enosebe Enugi of Ewohimi, Chief Dennis Osadebe, Barrister Gabriel Longe, Chief Festus Okutian, Senator Dalton Asemota, Chief Jack Usman, Chief AYAK, Chief Basuyi, G.I.G. Onya, when in 1950, at the regional conference held in Ibadan, the capital of the Western region, elected representatives from Benin and Delta provinces argued for a separate state for the Midwest. Consequently, the National Convention of Nigerian Citizens, NCNC, made the question of the creation of the Midwest state an election issue during the federal elections of 1959. After the election, a coalition government was formed at the center with the NCNC as a partner.
It was a real struggle. At the end of the day, there was no alternative other than to create it. And say, okay, we go. At that time, but there were lots and lots of challenges. For instance, accommodation was a major problem. And that the center of government at the time was the ring road where you have the museum now. Virtually all the ministries were there at the start of the new state. And again, shortage of manpower, structure, restructuring the whole place in alignment with the new environment in which people found themselves. It was not an easy thing. It's like packing to a new house where you have nothing. And the greatest challenge was that a lot of what should have gone with asset sharing for the state did not come. You see? So a lot of ending lives fed back. It was a misjoy.
Finally, on Saturday, 13th July 1963, a plebiscite was held in Benin and Delta provinces to legally ascertain the wishes of the people as to whether they desire to have a separate state of their own or remain part of the Western region. The victory was celebrated all over Nigeria, except in the West, where the sense of loss led to the refusal to share assets or give a party cake to the jealous Midwesterners. Nigeria thus became a country of four regions. The dreams of Oba Eweka became a reality.
The referendum, the plebiscite, and the final creation of Midwest region has been a blessing to Nigeria, as you can see. in terms of opportunities, the local governments at that time were able to give numerous scholarships to young Midwesterners at that time to go to school across the country and even abroad. There are many people today who benefited from those opportunities to further their education.
Yes, yes. The political and economic exploitation of the minority was a major complaint of the people of Edo and Delta under that regional and federal system that led to this agitation. What has changed within the context of those complaints of minority oppressions? Politically, do we have a very effective mechanism in place to deal with the minority question that was a major question 60 years ago?
Well, upon reflection, you know, there's been some progress, there's been some improvement. The 1979 Constitution, on paper, seemed to have addressed some of these issues. But in reality, you know, not much has changed. What simply has happened is that the federal government has now replaced the Western region. And has done so in a very Machiavellian way. First, in terms of the revenue allocation system, the center keeps almost 52% of the revenues of the federation, and they have, they give 28% to the states, to 36 states, and then the rest goes to the local governments. So with that disproportionate share of the federal government, that is the disproportionate of the federal government, unfortunately the federal government has not been able to undertake those responsibilities which the Constitution provides, as a result of which it's given the lion's share of the revenues. And interestingly, the minority states, or the states with minorities, are the states where the bulk of the resources are derived from. Yes, they claim that there's a 13% derivation, but that is paltry compared to what goes to the center. But I believe that what is even more worrisome today is the way we've gone about implementing our federalism, where nobody seems to be able to have a check and control on the activities of the federal government. It's better to have 36 points of failure than one single point of failure. What is happening in the country today is, with the failure of a central government, the entire country is almost comatose. Take things like road network. Take the major national trunks today are in a very, very bad state, and Nigerians can't traverse this country. The issue of security, where security, even though we're on a federation, security is centralized, and the states that that allocated 28% of the revenues now have a responsibility to take care of a federal security apparatus where the federal government is supposed to have the lion's share of the resources. And we could go on and on and on. The federal government delves into things that should be within the remit of states and local governments. How can the federal government still be keeping marriage registry, for instance? It's the responsibility of local governments, to justify the larger portion of the revenues, national revenues that go to that they need to keep. So to answer your question, I will summarize that yes, we've made some progress, but from the state of the country today, you will confirm yourself that we're far from where we should be.
It's a feat never repeated again in Nigeria. So this is historic, and we should be proud of what we have done. The governor referred to the Edo model, which I'm sure we'll get to hear a lot about later on. My entry point this morning is to provide a conceptual, a theoretical, an historical, and a practical framework within which all of this would be understood. And the title of my presentation is Referendums and Federal Solutions. Referendums are an essential instrument for bargaining in federal systems. The essence of federalism is precisely the fact that it offers a bargaining framework within which diverse groups and states can agree on how to stay together. What is central to that bargain is the fact that there is the notion of self-determination. And self-determination comes in diverse ways. The most peaceful way to arrive at self-determination and assert the right to self-determination is to ask the people, what do you want? Do you want a separate state or you want, you know, a merger, for instance? Now, that's the essence of the referendum or the plebiscite, as it is known. Federal solutions are solutions that are not cast in stone. They actually present to us a wide variety. And that variety begins with most elaborate form of the federal solution, which is federal government. But it extends to other varieties, such as decentralization, such as consociational democracy, such as devolution of powers, even in its own right, local government autonomy, and so on. These are varieties that can be referred to as federalism without federal government. But Nigeria does operate a federal government because we have a constitution. And referendums in the federal system would be the most peaceful if allowed. Most federal constitutions have provisions for people to decide where they want to belong. In the case of Nigeria, we had Southern Cameroon as part of Nigeria previously. In 1958 and in 1959, they were offered the opportunity to decide whether they wanted to belong to Nigeria or join Cameroon. The Adamawa province part of Cameroon decided they would merge with Nigeria. But the southern part, which used to be part of the eastern region, elected to merge with Cameroon. Now that's referendum at its best. We also have had, through our history, what you might call referendums. In 1986, we were considering whether to take the IMF loan or not. And the president, the military president at the time, decided we should have a national debate on that matter. Even though we didn't formally vote, the way we decided, those things were taken. But much earlier, in the run-up to the Macpherson Constitution of 1950, we had a kind of plebiscite that involved going to villages, to provinces, and to regions, and asking the people, which form of government do you wish to have in this country? Is it a federal system with a strong center, or with strong regions, or you want a unitary system? That was in the run-up to the Macpherson Constitution. So, for a long time, we've had these consultative ways of arriving at the people, because the essence of the referendum is that it encapsulates the people's power. It is the one that says you cannot do anything without the people and the groups that they belong to. So when you have a referendum such as we had in 1963, you were simply saying, Midwest people, what do you want? And the Midwest people voted. Albeit, they had great mobilization leading up to that process. 89% of those who took part in the referendum said we want a Midwest region. 89.07%. That was the outcome of that referendum. And as we have seen today, a lot of people had led that movement, beginning from Oba Eweka II, who actually had, as long ago as 1920, made a case for why we should be separate. That was that long ago. Today, we don't have the opportunity of another referendum. But what do we do with what we already have? To put this in proper perspective, I want to suggest, one, that there is no such thing as a true federalism. Every federal system decides the kind of federalism that it wants. If it works for it, that is its true federalism. American federalism is for America, Indian federalism is for India, Brazilian federalism is for Brazil. Nigeria must work out its own federalism, and this is part of the reason we are here. Okay? Now, I want to suggest a second that in the federal trajectory, you have federal systems that come through agreement and federal systems that are disaggregated through agreement for the same federal purpose. Nigeria was disaggregated because we didn't have independent units coming together to agree to form a federation. And that's where you can have it. In 1963, the Midwest referendum and the creation of the Midwest represented a very different trajectory. At that time, as you have heard, our problems in the Midwest were problems of internal colonialism in the Western region where we belonged. And therefore, we needed to liberate ourselves. We needed to be free. And we demanded a separate region to be separate from the Western region. At that time, the kinds of considerations that went into creation of units included, most importantly, the principle of viability. You couldn't become a region if you were not viable. Viability meaning that you needed to demonstrate your capacity to operate and function as an autonomous tier of government. Now, in 1976, the Rickefeld panel report took page to the whole idea of viability. It said what the governor repeated in that short excerpt that we just viewed. Rickefeld commission panel said, it is no longer necessary for states to be viable. The viability of Nigeria depends on the viability of the federal government. If the federal government is viable, then its constituent units will be viable. Now, that has taken us to where we are today. The whole point being that today, not many subnational units can be regarded as viable. Why has this come to be the case? It is because, in its own understanding, the military took us away from a region-centered federal trajectory to a nation-centered federal trajectory, where all states and local governments became distribution outlets for federal resources. The question of autonomy no longer mattered. States didn't need to be viable. Instead, the greater connections you had to the federal government, the more assured you were that you would develop. So nobody needed to do anything anymore. That's where we are today. And what I want to say to you is that in 1963, we had the federal system that proceeded on the basis of the balance of two forces. The forces of centralization and decentralization, because decentralization and centralization are variants of the same trajectory, and the forces of non-centralization, meaning that the powers and the autonomy enjoyed by the constituent units could not be centralized, could not be taken over from. Now, in the nation-centered trajectory, the whole idea of non-centralization, which describes the powers that belong to the states as constituent units, has become such a big problem. And that's where we are today. Some say we should return to the 1963 Constitution, and that is where the solution is. Let us not forget two points. The first is that, yes, the Midwest case was well made, but it was the political dynamics of the time, the fact that the federal government becoming a very strong power, wanted to decimate every region of opposition that helped our cause. because the creation of the Midwest owed a lot to the federal government's determination to crumble the Western region. That's all. We did well, and today this is what we're doing. So, what does the future look like? What's the future for Edo? We're asking, what is the future for Nigeria? Because if we don't resolve the question of the frame of federalism that we desire, whether it be region-centered federalism or we continue with the nation-centered federalism, we cannot resolve the Edo question. It's a question of the manner of federal solutions that we want. But let me tell you, and this is in conclusion, Your Excellency, where we're having many problems today. The military has given us this form of federalism. Most of the operators of our federalism today belong to the class of army brought ups, ABUs. That's what they are called. Army brought ups. Army brought ups only know one form of federalism, and this is the military authored federalism. We need to demilitarize our thinking, our conception, and democratize the army brought ups so that we can save them and save us from them. This is the end of my presentation.
Another applause, the sustain for the erudite professor. Thank you very much. A panel moderator and the panelists. Please warmly make welcome Professor Uyilawa Uswangale. Please applaud them, thank you very much. His Excellency Ambassador Okoyo Toyo and Dr. Aki Baba Ahmed. So we'll also invite Professor Eddie Eragwe. Can we please welcome the former orator of the Green University of Benin?
You will kindly excuse me. My last outing was ambassador to Scandinavia, where there's not too much of protocol. Convening this big convocation for us to discuss one of the most important subjects that we should interrogate in today's Nigeria. On a personal note, I want to bring greetings from the governor and the people of Bayelsa State. As we said yesterday, and has been highlighted today, sometimes the history books don't contain the fact that a quarter to a third of Bayelsa was part of Midwest region, part of Midwest state, part of old Bender state, and till late some part of Delta state. So we were critical of the site. I also bring greetings from our elder statesman chief, Dr. Edwin Clark, whom we have listened to. Years is a time for us to reflect on the journey taken so far and for us to see where we have been and where we need to go. I'm happy, Professor Egosa has already set the tone, and I would like to take him back to start off the conversation. You have 7 minutes. Now you share it. You can take 4 minutes now, take 3 minutes later. But definitely, you'll short 7 minutes. Prof, you mentioned there is no set type of federalism that the peoples of any given political space will have to work out their own type of federalism. That is a very tenable position, because people have easily referred to the situation of old Soviet Union, where they believed that their model of federalism, which was very centrist, was the best. Or the type of what Hitler tried to do in the top right, when he had a referendum, and they supported him, that he should do some of what he did. And there are no irreducible standards of federalism. When we go back to 1963, there were expectations by the fathers, family fathers. There were irreducible standards. And from what we saw, there were irreducible standards. So are there no standards that we could have maintained over the years?
Your Excellency, you're right. Federalism is many people, a system of government. But as I said, it's quite a variety that makes up the federal grid, and that's why we talk about federal solutions. But you see, there are basic federal principles, you know, that underlie all systems that are described as federal. The first is you should have at least two different levels of government. Each level of government must have matters on which it takes final decisions. That's one principle. Second principle is, in a thoroughgoing federal government, the powers that inhere in the states cannot be taken over by the federal government. If those powers are taken over, the system ceases to be federal. Now, these are important things. You also have constitutional frames and guidelines that are supposed to be sacrosanct, and that's why you have the judicial Supreme Court, especially, that interprets, you know, the meanings of those laws. Let me remind you, sir, that the Supreme Court of India ruled in the 80s that the Indian Union is an indestructible union of destructible units, by which it meant that whereas the union was sacrosanct, the component states were also sacrosanct. That is good federalism. You know, so within the bit of principles that are laid out, Casey Ware, who is the greatest authority of federal government, has said to us, countries that adopt the federal principles don't need to comply with the textbook prescriptions. They should only use these principles as guidelines for working out what is best for them. The Soviet Union that we referred to looked at its own circumstances and said, we should have a clause, which many other countries, including the United States and Canada, consider to be anti-federal. Ethiopia has a secession clause. You know, but these don't make them less federal than other federal systems like the United States or Canada, for instance. So Casey Ware said, and most students of federalism agree with this, work out federalism that works for you, because federalism is about the nature of societies it serves. It's not about complying with textbook prescriptions.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Professor G.G. Dab, Professor of Professors, you've spoken a lot on this subject matter in the past. What happened in 1963 was a great demonstration of the need to have space, political space, and also space for development of the constituent parts of this country. Tell us, what do you think went wrong? Are we satisfied with what has happened since that great success of 1963? The euphoria that came with it for political inclusion, the euphoria that came with it for cultural identity, the euphoria that came with it for developmental attainment of developmental aspirations. Because in what the governor in his opening remarks he spoke about, the lopsided nature of fiscal regime and so on. What went wrong? Or are we satisfied?
Thank you, Ambassador. I think it is correct to first recognize that Nigerians make a choice of federalism. From about 1950 to 1960, several conferences were held between Nigeria and the British colonial government to determine the kind of federalism we needed. So the 1960 constitution was the culmination, was the final agreement of that type of federalism. And that federalism was chosen because it was suitable for a multi-ethnic Nigeria, a country of many nations into one nation. Our federalism in 1960 recognized that reality. So, although there were regions, three regions at the time, which were inherited from colonial rule, but the three regions showed that they were still oppressing minorities within the regions. And this led to agitation for separate states. The one of the Midwest was the best organized, but there were other movements. There was the Calabar, Goja, Rivers state movement in eastern Nigeria. And there was the Middle Belt movement in what we call Benue Plateau at that time. But the Midwest movement was the best organized because it had good leadership. And we were consistent. And we were determined to be free from eternal oppression of Western region at the time. So we paid tribute to all the leaders who sacrificed their time. We have mentioned His Majesty. What has changed? Yes. What has changed can be determined by the fact that the military truncated the process of federalism. The military in 1966 killed federalism and imposed unitarism. Unitarism is the direct opposite of federalism. There's a key element there which we must recognize, which is supposed to sustain the next phase of the struggle. That key element is what we call derivation. That in a federal arrangement, the constituent units have control over their own resources, out of which they pay a tax to run a central government. That was what happened in 1960 to 63. And the Midwest government took off with that strong economic base, and the achievements were numerous. In fact, what the Midwest government did in 18 months, it established three industries, glass factory in Ugeli, textile mill in Asaba, and Okpelas in factory, all in 18 months. When the Midwest government continued under military, the solid foundation of that federalism helped Bermuda and Region to make progress. I need not mention but New Nigeria Bank, Ogbe Savior, University, they all came very fast because of that fiscal federalism. 50% of our own resources came back to us to use. At the moment, the military has stolen that money. That money has been stolen by the military and given to the federal government, and it has impoverished the states such that Delta State and Edo State combined are economically weaker now than they were in 1963. We must return to that federalism.
Professor Dara, thank you very much. Professor Edward, I have a view. Dara, humility. Some people think, no matter what you say about the military, they play a major role in bringing, keeping this country together and bringing our democracy elsewhere. Contextualize Decree 34, Unification Decree, which many people think
is the mother of all the problems, which abolished regionalism and the Midwest region that our fathers fought hard to sweat and blood, just with a whimper, was gone. And after that, Decree 14 of 1967, creating 12 states. And there. Now there's a clamor for restructuring. Professor Dara wants us to go back to 1963, to go back 50 years. Is there no better way of moving forward than rewinding 1963?
Thank you.
Bring this forward.
Thank you very much.
No, take this.
Okay.
Thank you. I want to really thank you for this opportunity to be part of this discussion. And to really say that the point that is raising, we were privileged to have been together at the National Conference in 2014 with our brother, Dr. Inabulele as well. And the fact is that this issue of restructuring has a lot of potentials, but also has a lot of attendant problems that will definitely make it an issue that must continuously be discussed and debated about. And that is that if we look at the role the military played by way of, yes, abrogating the regions, we could really say that they helped to answer to the needs of larger number of people that had taken place with the 1963, what we had as a rebel. Because, mentioned, first of all, we have to first of all realize that it wasn't just the people of Midwest alone that were agitated for regions at that time. Rather, the Ogoja area, as we mentioned, in different areas. But then it turned out that because of the political dynamics of the time, we were in court favored to get Midwest. So, what we are saying is that since that time, the creation of states, to a large extent, has answered and met the needs and yearnings of more people in terms of those that want to decide their own matters. But what is the problem now? It's what is the nature of the relationship between the center and the states. And that is why two major issues have been at the center of the discourse. What we call the devolution of powers, which is what areas the federal government is supposed to concentrate on, what areas are the states supposed to concentrate on, and the local government as a whole. And closely tied to that is the question of physical devolution as well, which, as we must realize, and that is the core of my presentation, is the challenges that are out there in trying to now restructure the physical relationship that is in place and the powers as they exist at the moment. But we believe that a lot can still be achieved. Why do I say so? In 2014, for example, where the discussions took place, a number of presentations were made to the extent that the devolution subcommittee, myself and Dara, we were there, we recommended that there should, because we know other states will exist, the issue of fiscal autonomy for the states, we recommended an upward major review in terms of the prohibition that is in place. That was supposed to have been implemented by the president. Then, of course, the issue of state police, which is talking about the pollution powers, we recommended at that time that states that are ready and have the capacity should be allowed to have their own state police. And what is the position here? We are saying that if you are going to give more responsibility to the states, then you must also empower the states. And that, like His Excellency rightly mentioned just now, and we freely came to his submission, is that you cannot give responsibility without rejigging the extant formula in terms of revenue share. The federal must release more to the states and local government because they are the ones that carry greater responsibility and are in greater contact with the people of the country.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
we have a lot of our colleagues, or some of our colleagues online, and it has been a main affair so far. Only men on the podium, which sometimes are shy away from, because it's slightly below the United Nations standard. But fortunately, we have a lady who is joining us also online. So I'd like to call Ambassador Okoye Otoyo, a great friend and one-time Nigerian ambassador to Ethiopia, to the Organization of African Union, and later African Union. So, Okoye, Ambassador Okoye, please, would you want to share some thoughts still on this topic of where this spirit of 1963 has taken us so far? I would like you to also, with the audience here, slightly more than 50% are women. And effectively has been doing a lot of work. Please, let's give a round of applause. I would like you to also speak on that theme in terms of inclusion of women, youth, and other vulnerable groups in governance. Please, media, can you connect Ambassador? Tell you, please.
By Professor Lisa, is the future has to be a conversation between whether we want to stay in the center, which is the legislation centered approach to federalism, or we want to return to the regions and the region centered approach to federalism. The push should not be one of the other. The push should be how do we get more the country as their country. And that's where the issue of young people, women, persons with disability, persons of different class, that very different people and cannot necessarily trace their origin to a particular geography becomes very important. There are people who are coming to Nigeria but they are those who are residents. They are all important parts of this conversation. Therefore, I believe that the conversation should be not just about job. My God, can you hear me?
We can hear you very well. Go.
The conversation should not be just about geography. It should be about inclusions. How do you build inclusions in a country where we are desperate of national need for the purpose of development? And I think that that is a new tension that exists. On the one hand, we want to keep what we have, and I have heard the comment made about how we can send more resources to the regions, but there is also the question of how do you sustain national unity and national development. So my comments will go this way, that we need to build a federalism as well as a country that takes care of all its citizens. As I speak to you, sometimes the regional context ignores the situation of smaller minorities. I come from a small minority, and I know that, for example, the dynamics in the South-South tends to privilege certain minorities over other minorities, and that in itself is a problem. As a woman, I have the same jeopardy of being marginalized in many respects, and that issue of bringing governance closest to the people addresses the needs of people like mine, who are both micro-minorities as well as women. So in effect, what Adosa has left us with is a concept that says we can redesign our federalism. We can redesign the basis under which we work as a country. And that is within our powers and our constitution to do. It is no longer the question, true, as some will have it discussed, but the question of what works for us. And what works for us And given what we see the young people telling us today, who are spread more than 60% of the country, they want to see a country, a new country, give them development. And if it is going to be about development and what the future represents, it must be inclusive of all cadre of persons, whether they be women, young, old, a resident, non-resident.
Still keep our Ambassador Koyo, because the network might not be too good. Can you hear me? I have another question for you. You were a member of the House of Representatives. During the 1963 plebiscite, there was a strong bipartisan, there was a strong pan-Nigerian approach. So even the actual motion for the plebiscite was moved by the instance of the Prime Minister at the time, who was from the North. Now, these days when people talk about restructuring or in any way trying to open up the fiscal space, there's strong opposition. Can you still hear me if she's still on? As a former member of the House of Representatives, how can we work towards getting rejigging once more that elite consensus towards seeing the benefit of such widening of the political space? If she's not on again, maybe Professor, I can ask her that question. So, you want to teach it? Okay, yes, Professor Agbaje.
The question you already asked.
Yes.
Around the major issues.
Like what happened in 1963.
Exactly. I think the good news, taking it from the name, closing up,
yes,
is that we have seen Nigerians, when they discuss national issues, there can be convictions. And that played out, for example, the 2014 conference, where there were not common grounds at the time the conference ended. And there were those recommendations that if they should have been implemented, we definitely believe it would have been better than where we are today. The other good news, and we are blessed to have here the great senator from our state, is that the National Assembly, to a large extent, met this as the ninth National Assembly, answered some of the questions that were raised by 2014 conference. So it is possible that through political negotiations and all, these things can still be changed and give us a better country than what we have.
Thank you very much. I'm sure when our comrade Senator Excellency comes to talk, we will deal with that matter. But let me, Ambassador Nkoye was back where we lost again. Yes, Professor Osiris. Please, go.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Hello.
Sir.
Okay, I'll come back to
hello,
you.
Hi, how are you?
Okay, since you are the question
is our technical support. I just want to let you know that to be on standby.
Okay, I am on standby.
Alright, awesome. So please, I'm going to mute your mic. So when it's time for you to speak, I'll send a signal you see it on your screen. You click on it on mute.
We should really be able to speak.
Okay.
Okay,
thank you so much.
So to what extent can we get...
We're not connected to the program anymore. Can you hear them?
Oh, yeah, connected.
Okay, understand. All right, awesome. So please, I'm going to mute your mic. So when it's time for you to speak, I'll stay.
Okay, let us continue.
Had very wonderful in the National Assembly, but it appeared that they think that their greater responsibility is to do things that are nationalist and therefore prophetic in the manner of the Abbey Prophets that I talked about earlier. Whereas, you know, they are state representatives to plead the cause of the states. And this is a point that political philosophers have made over the ages. Parliament is where representatives of the people that the constituent units go to plead their causes. In South Africa, the members of the Senate, the upper chamber, were behaving like I've just described. and there was a constitutional tweak. They had to change the name to National Council of Provinces. So when you are elected to the National Council of Provinces, you know you are in that council to defend the interests of the province that has delegated you to go there.
I think they know that.
So I'm saying to our senators, that are still serving, I'm happy that our comrade, in some of his interventions, has pleaded the cause of our constituency at this stage. We should expect more of that. That's what I'm saying.
So let me spare you. There's a question I'm going to leave for comrade when it comes to last night. During the plebiscite and ahead of the plebiscite, our fathers worked together. They were together. NCNC, Action Group, NPC, and other smaller groups, they worked with a vision together. I would like to, when you come, Your Excellency, to address that matter. Because in the National Assembly, to what extent have we done that, and how much can we do that? But now, I want to go to Ambassador Akin Baba Ahmed, because you seem to be the only panelist from across the other side of the Niger. And we've been through this many times in several forums. Please, can you bring him if you can? Technology? Until in 1962 and early 1963, the Prime Minister, who was from the North, came out with bustling to support the fact that there was need for more widening of the political space. Today, when this question of restructuring devolution of power came up, there appears to be a pushback on the same matter. What has changed? Because there was a time our fathers used to think as one, and it was people from the North that championed and joined our own fathers from this side. So, can I count on you on continuing with this trajectory? Please, can you give him some money? We are still having some serious problem. Let's give a round of applause. We'll hear you later. Thank you very much. Okay, please.
All right. Well, thank you. Good morning, everyone.
Yes, go on.
Please unmute your mic.
Hello? We can hear you, bro.
I've obviously joined here. There's a big picture there.
Are the key resource control and key derivation. To resume that struggle, the government of Delta and Edo should be in the front line
and Bayelsa
and extend it to South.
Yes.
They should remain resilient and formidable, courageous, brave, indomitable, demanding a return and restoration of fiscal federalism. 100% of our resources, we pay a tax to Abuja.
Don't forget,
Ambassador. It is money from the Midwest that funded the Civil War. It is the money from oil and gas of the Midwest that built Lagos. It is the money of oil and gas from the South that built Abuja. That money should be returned to us. When that resource is returned to us, we will perform like UAE in Arabia, we will perform like Malaysia, we will perform like Hong Kong. Federalism means resource control. It should be restored as a precondition for the future of Nigeria.
It will be fitting to take, we'll take very few questions, just of which two, one must be a woman and one must be a youth, not youth of 40 years, but a youth of below 30 years.
Akbasis from Benin, also speaking from the National Youth Council. We want to thank our fathers who are giving us histories and information that is very rare to many young persons today. And we want to say that vocally from this angle of the youth that we support this mission and this proposals being set today. But we have one question. Where does our fathers need the young persons to come in? Because you and I know that this whole thing will not work if the young persons are not part of it. And we do not want a food being cooked while we are outside. We want to be part of the cooking. So where do we come in and when do we come in? And what date is this step going to start? That is my question.
Thank you very much. Nigeria, great popular youth. Okay, thank you. The panelists will answer that question.
We know that we live in the richest country in the world. Even as Zambia, they are picking it from the ground. They've not started digging for it yet. So we know that we're going to be extremely rich eventually. But for now, my contribution would be to say that if Londoners can surreptitiously be stealing the gold and not bringing it to us or to the central government, we should come up with our own ways too now. Abi, the more you look, the less you see. Thank you. Thank you very much.
It's for a woman. We have taken the youth question, but we have a question of time. Unless there is no woman who wants to say anything.
President of World Medical Association. Incidentally, I was in the national conference with Professor Dara and Professor Ege Irabu. And so I will not further elaborate on what they've said. I clearly accept that there is need for fiscal federalism, the issue of devolution of power. But let me address one issue, which we seem not to apply, but I think that is also part of the elephant in the room. Yes, we agree that there is need for fiscal federalism, but we also understand that unless and until we address the issue of good governance, we will continue to have discussions that seem to, of course, transform us into what I call sorry appendages of sham reformism. In other words, the recklessness of governance. How do you enthrone a regime of accountability where the people are able to afford the money for good governance and accountability from their leaders? Because even if you throw all the resources into a state and that state has no good governance, you'll just be wasting that time. So I think these discussions beyond the issue of fiscal federalism must also talk about the accountability structures, the governance structures, so that we can have value for money. Each time I travel abroad, I see small states, not even up to our states, doing pitifully well. It is because of the whole concept of good governance, rule of law. I therefore want to submit that beyond the discussions, let us also be able to build that structure to give people value for money. Thank you.
Where integrity, fairness, justice is not thriving, when resource control is returned to us, what will happen? And if the society is not having all of those qualities, what standards are we to set? Because when we were growing up, we were told that wherever we go, wherever we be, we should not say yes when we need to say no. So we need to bring back our children, our society, to mean yes when they need to say yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
As it is now, most governors, most people are subscribing. If you are not a friend of the president in Abuja, you are in trouble. We must remove that obstacle. We must remove the states and make them autonomous so that they can be accountable to their own people. And the most best way to be accountable is for us to be in charge of our own resources, as I have said. Let the governors Delta Edo, the one of Bayelsa, and the rest of SASA, they should support SASA and Middle Belt Forum, Leaders Forum, which is now the platform for advocating the implementation of the 2014 National Conference. Resource control
or no federation.
Thank you. Yes, of
course, yes. One of the very veritable reasons we can continue to advocate for further devolution of power and then more resources going to the state is the performance of the Midwest region and the performance of the states that came out from the region, to the extent that just like our chief Ike Park mentioned just now, so many things were not getting done to the region at the time. But with the creation of the Midwest, those things started getting again. With the creation of Edo State, for example, Delta and others, and the performance of some of our governments, we are proud to say that if more resources are given to them, then definitely the states will be better than they are today. There is what we call state-centered initiatives that are already played out. And our recommendation here is that if there are any obstacles, as far as coming from the federal arrangements that concern them, those obstacles should be removed. And finally, it is that just like Mr. Osaga has mentioned, our representatives at the National Assembly, for example, our representatives in the federal government should know that their primary first responsibility is the areas that they are representing. And that was how, during the conference, myself, himself, the representatives from that is Akwa Ibom and River State, we were able to work together as a team representing the South South. That can still be done to make sure that we get the best out of the system. Thank you very much.